these times during COVID, when we're all sitting at home, it's sort of like a ray of light that we get to watch these amazing sessions when we can't all be together. It certainly brightens up my evenings.
आज पेंडेमिक में हम डिजिटली जयपुर लिटरेचर फेस्टिवल कर रहे हैं और मुझे लगता है कि हमारे सामने श्रोता नहीं है, हम आपस में बात कर रहे हैं, लेकिन उस फील को, उस उमंग को महसूस कर सकते हैं कि हजारों लाखों लोग हमसे जुड़े हुए हैं, हमको सुन रहे हैं और कहीं ना कहीं कोई सार्थक हस्तक्षेप हो रहा है.
People who came online to view and listen to our incredible speakers from across the world, we were able to continue in our tradition of ensuring the free flow of knowledge and information.
On behalf of Namita Gokhale, William Dalrymple, Sanjoy Roy, and all of us at Teamwork Arts, I welcome you to this session of the Jaipur Literature Festival Online Series 2021. Today we present A Passion for India, Javier Moro. Javier Moro in conversation with Mohini Gupta. Presented in partnership with the Cultural Relations Platform, Creative Europe, EUNIC India, Embassy of Spain, and the delegation of the EU to India. A glimpse into the inspirations and journeys of celebrated Spanish writer, producer, and scriptwriter Javier Moro and his unique relationship with India. Through a literary career spanning over two decades, Moro has often constructed narratives inspired by the country's rich socio-cultural roots. In conversation with Mohini Gupta, he discusses the essence of his writing process and inimitable style. Javier Moro made headlines in India when he published the Red Sari in 2013, which is a dramatized biography of Sonia Gandhi. It unfurls the inspirational path of the Gandhi matriarch and her journey through the Indian political and social landscape. He's one of the most acclaimed and widely read Spanish novelists and has written extensively on India. The Jaipur Foot, The Mountains of the Buddha, Five Past Midnight in Bhopal with Dominique Lapierre, and Passion India, a narrative that follows the marriage of a Spanish girl to the Maharaja of Kapurthala and the subsequent scandal that shook British India. He was awarded the Premio Planeta, the Spanish language's most prestigious award in 2011 for El Imperio Eres Tú, the story of Brazil's first emperor and the making of the Brazilian nation, and in 2018 for his novel, Me Picaro. Mohini Gupta is currently pursuing her PhD in language politics at the University of Oxford. She founded the multilingual digital collective Mother Tongue Twisters to promote Indian language poetry for young readers and curate conversations on literary translation. Mohini was Charles Wallace India Trust translator, writer, fellow in 2017 for creative writing and translation hosted by Literature Across Frontiers. An alumna of SOAS University of London, she has been a research fellow at SRI, CSDS. She has written on languages, literature, and translation for publications such as Huffington Post, The Caravan Magazine, The Wire, Scroll, and The World Kit Lit blog. Her English-Hindi translations have been published by Tulika Publishers. All our sessions that have been broadcast till now are available on our website in the mobile tent venue, and also on our Facebook and YouTube channels. Before we begin the session, it is our pleasure to present a message from Oscar Pujol, director, the Instituto Cervantes, New Delhi.
Hi, everybody. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce this conversation, A Passion for Indian, between the Spanish writer Javier Moro and Mohini Gupta at the digital series of the Jaipur Literature Festival. This has been made possible thanks to the joint initiative of the delegation of the European Union to India and the New Delhi cluster of the European National Institutes for Culture. My special thanks to all my unique colleagues and to Raymond Magis, the deputy head of the delegation. Javier Moro has more than 5 books on India, including The Red Sari and Indian Passion. But even past his love for India, his work tells us about the adventure of being human beyond cultural particularities, the adventure of crossing the boundaries between nations and riding between different sets of values. He has entered the common house of human experience and has opened the doors of so many different rooms inside that house, the room of India, the room of Brazil, the room of Spain, and of so many other countries. He's a truly multicultural man, who knows how to live beyond prejudice And I am sure this conversation will go a long way in showing us the way to break the barriers that still separate us. So let's enjoy it. And thanks, Javier, for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Pujol, for joining us. Ladies and gentlemen, we now present A Passion for India, Javier Moro. Javier Moro, in conversation with Mohini Gupta, presented in partnership with the Cultural Relations Platform, Creative Europe, Unique India, Embassy of Spain, and the delegation of the EU to India.
Thank you so much for inviting me here, and it's really a privilege to be here in conversation with author Javier Moro. Hi, Javier, welcome to the conversation.
Thank you very, very much. I'm also, for me, it's a great opportunity, and I thank very much the organizers for inviting me in one of these sessions.
I'm really looking forward to hearing more about your work and your relationship with India, your passion for India. Do you want to tell us how that began, actually? We can just sort of jump right into your relationship with India and where that first began.
I came for the first time to India when I was 13. That was a long time back. I was 1967, 68. And believe me, India was not what it is today. For a 13-year-old kid from Europe, I was absolutely mesmerized. I mean, everything was so different. So I remember there were camels, there were bears in front of the old Taj Mahal Hotel in Bombay, which at that time it was still the old hotel. The room didn't have air conditioning yet. It was a fan in the ceiling. It was like, you know, it was a country from, it was not a geographical trip. It was a trip into the past, to another era, to another universe. And that shocked me. And I kept a magnificent souvenir from that first trip. And then I came back many years later, when I was an adult, I came back helping my uncle Dominique Lapierre with his researches. And somehow some of his love story with India got to me also. And I started, you know, meeting people and coming regularly and knowing society and knowing Indian, you know, in India, every trip a little bit more. And I also fell in love with India, and I found always extremely inspiring subjects to write about. One of my first book, The Jaipur Food, was the story of Dr. Sethi, who was a Gandhian, that man that invented the prosthetics that's the most widely used in the world, the famous Jaipur Food. And I remember spending, you know, evenings and evenings and afternoons talking with him. He was a very good talker, and he was he loved to tell his story in his house in Jaipur, then visiting the hospital. And little by little, you know, I just kept relationship more with the society, and I found great stories to tell.
Yeah, I mean, it is a wonderful story to tell. And I was wondering if you could also tell our listeners a little more about, you know, your uncle, Dominique Lapierre, who has, of course, influenced your relationship with India. And also you've co-authored, you know, one of your books with him as well. So could you tell us about maybe a little more about him for the listeners, and also about your book, so writing relationship?
He would be so happy to see this session, you see, and so proud. Because my uncle Dominique was a little bit my father also. I lost my father at a young age. And he kept a little bit that role, and we both share that that love for India. He's now I'm going to see him. He's going to be 90 in a few days, and he's in a nursing home in south of France. Unfortunately, he's lost his memory, and he fell and had an injury in the brain, and he doesn't really know who he is anymore. But he's still alive. And he still feels when somebody close to him visits him. So I will see him, and he would be absolutely delighted to see this session. Yes, I worked with him and with Larry Collins in several of their books as a researcher. They hired a bunch of researchers. I was one of them. And that helped me a lot to learn the trade and to learn the craft. how to organize very big documentations, how to go through the research so that you don't get crazy at the time of writing it and you know where things are, otherwise you spend your time looking for things. I mean, all that method, that technique, I learned a lot. And then he invited me, which was very generous from him, to join forces and write a book on Bhopal. I was going to write a book on Chernobyl. And he asked me, he said, well, don't you prefer to spend, you know, 2 years in India than in Kiev, where it's so cold and they only eat boiled potatoes? I said, yeah. When I thought about it, I said, yes, of course. And then he gave me the definitive argument, which was, you know, Chernobyl, everybody, there's a lot of books written on Chernobyl. It will be in our memory because it happened here. But who will remember Bhopal? Nobody. So let's do something about it. And that was really a very, very powerful argument to convince me to join forces with him. And then I came to Bhopal and I discovered a wonderful city between those lakes with wonderful monuments that, I mean, it's a pity that they aren't preserved at all. It's really very, very sad to see how they are decaying. Nobody does anything about that. It has a very, very important heritage, Bhopal. And I met, I stayed like for 6 months solid in Bhopal. It was my longest time in India in a single. And I got, that's where I really got to know Indian society, because I interviewed everybody in Bhopal. I got to know that city quite well. I interviewed poor people, all those victims that had fell during the gas tragedy, but yet I also interviewed, you know, the executives who run that company, the policemen, the army, I mean, everybody. I got really there, you know, close. I mean, to know Indian society better, and I loved that time in Bhopal. You know, I loved being there, and I still have links there, and I visit every time I go to India. I visit the Sambhavna Clinic, which cares to the victims of Bhopal. And something happened with that book that reinforced my vocation of writing. With the money we got out of the royalties of the fast 5 past midnight in Bhopal, we helped create a clinic, Sambhavna Clinic, who cared for the gas victims. And there's something magical. I remember the day we inaugurated the clinic with Satyanath Sarangi, who runs it from these days. I remember that with a pen and a notebook, you can somehow, I mean, it would be presumptuous to say you can change the world, but you can really bring something concrete into the world that makes it a better place, if only for the existence of Sambhavna Clinic, you know? And it shows you that writing is not only a pastime for people who have a lot of time to spare, but that writing can be an instrument of change. And it was a feeling of utter, I don't know how to describe it in English. My words don't come easy because I don't practice English lately, but it was a sense of fulfillment that I experienced very, very seldom in my life. And that was when we finished 5 past midnight in Bhopal. Unfortunately, the tragedy of Bhopal still unfolds. Justice hasn't been made. And it's still, a hurt in the skin of humanity. I mean, somehow one solution has to be found at the end of the rope. And then Mohini, to forget Bhopal, I remember I went to a cocktail party in Delhi at one, and I met a relative of the Maharaja Jagajit Singh of Kapurthala. In fact, an old cousin of his, and she talked to me of that Spanish wife of the Maharaja of Kapurthala, Anita Delgado. And I had heard, of course, of Anita Delgado, and I had I knew her story, but vaguely. And she told me of the scandal when she got in love. She fell in love with a son. It was the son of the Maharaja.
Right.
And then it something clicked in my head. I said, since I'm in India, I'm going to research that. And I went to interview part of the family that still lived in Delhi. And little by little, I got, you know, hooked into this book that for me was a change. Bhopal was a hard book to write and a hard book to research. And this was for me, you know, a book of history, the possibility of depicting the India of the Raj through the point of view of a Spanish woman. And I really thought that book was never going to be a hit, really, because I saw it as a little story, but I loved it. And to my surprise, that was my biggest hit. I mean, it was translated, I don't know how many languages. It sold a couple of million copies. I mean, it still is, it's a book that runs around.
It is these little sort of untold, hidden stories that people really find interesting, right? And it somehow just strikes a chord with the audiences and works out.
Yeah, but you don't know what strikes the chord with the audience. If you knew, everybody would be a writer or a producer or a movie director. Nobody knows. And in fact, now it's easy to say that Passion India had all the elements to be a bestseller. But when I was writing it, I didn't see any of these elements. You know, who cares about a Spanish woman, a poor Spanish woman who at the beginning of the 20th century married Maharaja in India. He even wasn't the biggest or the most powerful of the Maharajas. He was a small Maharaja. And look, you know, life is full of surprises, and this profession is even more full of surprises. You don't know. In fact, you don't have to think about how to please the audience. I think that's the best recipe for failure. You have to really think of what pleases yourself. How do you really have this feeling of happiness that writing provides you? You know, what makes you happy? With the hope that it may make happy your readers. But it's never sure. It's absolutely never sure. Look, even the Bhopal book, I mean, who would think that that book would be a worldwide success? You know, it was a terrible story to tell. Mm-hmm. I mean, the challenge with Bhopal, and we talked a lot with Dominique about that, was how to tell such a tragedy in a way that's appealing to the public, to the readers, to a wide readership. You know, you have to go and find the human element there, and that's what we did. In fact, the Bhopal book, it's a story of all those lives that got intertwined in this tragedy, from the the peasants who came to the shadow of the factory for a better future, to the story of the architect, the chemists who came to work there, who were wearing that United Union Carbide uniform with such pride. And look at the end, what happened.
That's very tragic. I can imagine, as someone who's telling that story, you do get very immersed in the lives of people, the story itself, and it can be very emotionally taxing. And it's very interesting that the themes of your books have been so diverse, like you were saying, you know, from the Bhopal book to the book about the Spanish lady. And then there was, of course, another book which, you know, is very well known and popular and also brought a lot of sort of controversy with it. Would you like to talk to us about that one?
Yes, the Red Sari. In fact, in India, I am known as the author of the Red Sari, as if I hadn't written any other book. Yes, the Red Sari. I mean, still nobody knows why they reacted like that. It shows you that at that time, Congress Party had real problems of communication and marketing, because if they didn't want the book to be noticed, they did everything for the book to be a blockbuster, you know? I mean, I could have dreamt of a better marketing campaign from a publisher than what Congress Party did to that book. And I still don't know why. why they got so upset, because that book is a book that tells a, it's a book to the glory of the Gandhis in a way. Mm. I mean, the Gandhis as the people who somehow opened India to modernity. I mean, and secularism. I remember there is a scene there. I had interviewed so many people for that book also. I interviewed Ashwini Kumar, who at that time, who had been the head of the frontier police for years. And Ashwini Kumar told me the story, you know, when he saw Indira Gandhi after what happened in Amritsar, the operation Blue, I don't remember the name.
Blue Star. But,
yes, exactly. And he told her, you know, you should change your bodyguards because it's dangerous to you. And he told me that she turned her head to him and said, aren't we secular? And she never changed her bodyguards, and they turned on her, and, you know, and well, we know the rest of the story. She was killed. You know? I mean, those things, I got a lot of those kind of testimonies. I think it's a book that still is widely read all over the world, because I still keep you know, messages from readers from South America, from Italy, because it's not only the story of Sonia Gandhi. Sonia Gandhi was a little bit of a pretext to tell the India after the independence, you know, the birth of modern India, and through a family history.
It covers some of the most defining political moments in the country as well.
Yes, absolutely. And those characters, I try to portray them, you know, very close to what they really were, you know, not being Manichaeist. And it's not a story of good and bad, you know. Indira had extremely very critical sides to her, but she was also a fabulous woman from a point of view of a writer. Good drama. She provided very, very good drama. And the story of Sonia Gandhi was fabulous when you think about it. Mm. You know, she was somebody who was not educated for that. She hated power. She hated politics. She was extremely shy and very private. She was so private that once when a team of the French television, Channel 5, came to do a family portrait, a family film on Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi, at the end, when they wanted to do a family shot, and she refused to join. Even she said, not Rajiv. You know, the fact that somebody like that ends up being the most powerful woman in a country of more than a billion people, being from foreign birth, it's a fabulous story. I mean, I'm talking independently of if you like them or you don't like them. I mean, as a story, it's fabulous. In fact, lots of people have tried to write that story. Even Tina Brown, the director of The New Yorker, she was crazy about the story of Sonia Gandhi. And Sonia never wanted a book on her. She said, you know, I mean, everybody knows in India how, you know, they're against media, and they will not help anybody. But I didn't care. I saw the story. I believed in that story so much. I saw it so clearly that it was a fabulous story that I went ahead. And of course, they didn't help me at all. I couldn't interview I got to see the family, but very, very little. I couldn't get the first circle of friendship. I met them all, but they all told me, no, you know, I'm not going to tell you anything about Sonia Gandhi, knowing that she doesn't want us to talk about her. I'm not going to jeopardize my position here, no way. And that was the standard answer from everybody. So I said, okay, I will do it with a third, fourth circle of acquaintances. You know, I got to meet the ex-secretary of Indira Gandhi, Usha Bhagat, who gave me very, very nice clues. And little by little, I could reconstruct their life at the house of the PM, how it was when suddenly Khrushchev or whoever was at power at that time, or Valéry Giscard d'Estaing decided to, he was invited to dinner at Indira's house, and how Sonia organized that dinner, what was the smell at the, in that house, what flowers did they put in the vases, how did they celebrate their birthdays, their dates, you know, and I could, you know, reconstruct her life pretty accurately. Still, it's a novel because you know, it's not purely nonfiction, but it's very close, and I think that was what sent them mad. You know, they were because why they reacted in a way that was totally and proportionate, with no proportion with the content of the book. I think the when I ask her lawyer, but why are you so mad with this book? Well, you have told in the book that she was the daughter of a very poor shepherd, a cow shepherd in Italy. And I mean, I realized that they didn't like the fact that I told her life. That's for once. And that I told her life, you know, from her origins. And I think there was a cultural thing also. Because in Europe, if your dad is a cow shepherd and ends up being a builder or a bank president, somehow you feel proud of it. And in certain sections of Indian society also. But maybe in other sections of Indian society, that means that you're a low caste. And all the effort of Congress Party was to portray Sonia Gandhi as the wife of Rajiv Gandhi as royalty. She doesn't belong to Italy anymore. She's Indian, you know, because she was subject to such harsh attacks from the opposition. She still is, I think, that the only way they could find to manage that was to try to convince everybody that she was Indian. Nobody questions that. Of course, she became Indian when she married Rajiv. And that transformation from a European woman into an Indian woman is one of the themes of the book. And it was one of the themes that attracted me so much to write that story. It was fabulous. How did she do it? But still, you know, she was born in Italy and she still was Italian. You cannot. But they didn't like that. And they didn't like that, for example, when Indira declared the emergency, I wrote that Sonia was very worried for the safety of her son, of her children, which is normal. I mean, the country was in, you know, an upheaval and nobody knew what could happen. And she thought of taking them to Italy for a while. And I took that, I don't know if from an old magazine, an interview or a book about Indira. I don't know, I had not invented that. That was not mine. I took it from somewhere. And oh my God, she never wanted to leave. She's Indian, she will stay here. She never thought of going back to Italy. Such a ridiculous nationalism, you know. Well, that's the story of the book. But they did a war on me that was at the beginning. I was terrified. I mean, they were sending me these mails. I was in Guadalajara film book festival. I received these mails. We're going to sue you. We're going to sue all your publishers. The book was out in I don't know how many countries. We're going to ask for retrieval of the copies from the shelves. But they never sued me. Well, I was prepared because, you know, that book was pretty well documented. I could prove, you know, I took this from there. I interviewed this person in Italy because I went to Italy. I went to the village where she was born. I went to the village where she lived her teen years. I interviewed the man who sold her an ice cream every day after school in the summer, the neighbors. I mean, I had done all that. So I think they thought they didn't have ground. but they threatened. And in fact, they got a bit of what they wanted. They didn't want that book to be published in India then. And my publisher, Pramod Kapoor, and myself decided not to publish it because there was such a climate of violence. When I saw myself, my effigy being burnt on TV, I was in Spain, thank God. I saw it through internet. But I saw my effigy being burnt by Youth Congress elements that were chanting, you know, Moro Murtabad, Moro Murtabad. And then they set fire on a bag that was supposed to be myself. Like if I was, I don't know, George Bush at that time, you know, I was my Salman Rushdie, Spanish Salman Rushdie for a while. That was a joke here. But it was, you know, it was not nice as a publicity, I must say. The effect, as I told you before, was totally the opposite of what they tried. As soon as Sonia lost the elections, that was November, I think, to 2014, 1 month in January 2015, I went to Delhi and we launched the book. And it was a huge hit. It was a huge hit. And then I remember Outlook magazine had published an issue of the magazine saying, "The book Sonia doesn't want you to read." And that was perfect for everybody, you know, for enticing everybody to read it.
Yeah, yes. It's incredible what you say about this opposite impact. And it's very true that, you know, the more attention it gets, the more sort of people are also curious about what's written in the book, you know.
Trying to find the terrible scandals that nobody else knew. They were trying to find, I don't know what they were trying to find. It appealed to this, you know, dark side of the people, what's in the book. And they waged war on the book when it wasn't even translating into English. Nobody had read it. Nobody had read it when they created that scandal. And I think when they read it in 2015, they mellowed it because they realized that was not a book that was looking for, you know, little things. And I still believe the Gandhis are honest people. And there is no fortunes in Italy. I saw the house where they lived. I saw, I interviewed their cousins. I mean, I saw them. And what I can tell you is they're not crooks, no way.
Your, you know, the thoroughness of your research is so incredible to know about, you know, the fact that you went to Turin, you know, sort of found so many circles of people who were connected with her. That really is incredible to know about. I want to sort of get into more details about the process of your writing, but I'm going to step back a little bit. You mentioned that this book wasn't even out in English at the time. And I was actually curious because, you know, I don't know how many people know that the books that you're so well known for, whether it's the Red Sari or 5 Past Midnight in Bhopal, they are originally in Spanish, the language that you write in. Yes. I was wondering about your relationship with the English translations. How closely do you work with the translator? What is your sort of,
I found a very good translator in Spain, Peter Hearn, and I worked very closely together. And my English is not very good. I mean, it's okay to get around. So I don't have a sense of good English literature when I read it. But I know for sure the meaning of what I wrote originally. And I could discuss it with him very freely. And I think he was a very, very good translator. And yes, we worked very hard on the revisions. And then we worked very hard on the Indian editions. It was edited by my friend Shekhar Malhotra, who was the publisher of the Bhopal book. Unfortunately, he died a month ago, very sad. And we worked very hard together to edit the Indian copy because there were a lot of things that were written for Westerners that you need to explain India more to Westerners. That explanation, you don't need it to Indian audience. So the book is a bit different in its Indian edition than it was in the European American editions. And yes, a terrible thing with the translator is that I had very, very terrible experiences with book translated. My book, which won the Planeta Award, one of Spain's biggest literary awards, it's about the story of the first emperor of Brazil and the birth of the Brazilian nation. And that book had to be translated very, very quickly into Portuguese because the publisher wanted the book to come out for the Christmas season, and they gave it to two translators. The result was such a disaster, Mohini. You cannot understand. I mean, I still get messages from readers in Brazil saying, we love the story, we love the book, but it's so poorly translated. But how come? And the problem with a translation is that you cannot redo a bad translation. I mean, you cannot correct a bad translation. You have to do it all over again from scratch. There is no way you can correct a poor translation. You go crazy. You waste so much time. It's better to start anew and then, you know. But lately I've been lucky. I've been lucky with my French translator and I've been lucky with my English translator. Yes, it was not the case with my Portuguese translator at that time.
Yeah, I was curious about that. And I hadn't thought about the Indian edition thing as well, which you said, you know, that you had to edit out bits to make it sort of less explanatory in the Indian version. That's yes. Also really interesting. I also wanted to ask you about something, again, very different, is that you also have a different life that's sort of in cinema and in films as well. Is that something that you continue to engage with, or is that something that was, a brief kind of
environment? No, I did that when I was much younger. In fact, I started doing cinema. I produced and wrote a movie in Spain that was quite successful here. Then I moved, I lived in Hollywood for 5 years. I wrote lots of stuff that was never made. Very frustrating to work for the movie industry, because first of all, you're not the sole responsible for the result. I mean, it's a group endeavor, movie making. Whether when you write, you're on your own. It's of course much lonelier, much more, you know, you're alone, but you're also the one who decides if that's good, if that's not good. For me, leaving Hollywood and starting writing in my own language, my own books, was an absolute liberation. That's how I felt it, and I still feel it. You waste so much time with all this movie making. Everybody's on a meeting always. Everybody talks about millions of dollars, and everybody talks about the third part who has to come in order that the thing gets made. You depend on others, and that's very depressing, I find. I mean, you're not the master of your own work. Whether, you know, with this and a computer, that's all you need to write a book. So I love books much better than the movies. Now, I'm not against, you know, a good producer, and I think it's gonna happen, that we'll take the book on Bhopal and make a wonderful series of it for Netflix or one of these platforms. Mm. But I don't really feel I should get involved. I did my best already. I put all my strength, all my energy into these books. It's good that a scriptwriter, younger and different, you know, brings his own breath of fresh air into a story.
I look forward to that. I hope that, you know, it's, I hope that you do convert it into a screen format and it just becomes accessible.
Yeah, but they say that my books are very expensive because they're period books, yes. And history is always expensive to recreate. You know, the marriage of the Maharaja of Kapurthala, or the entrance of that Spanish woman who didn't know anything at all about the world she was entering, you know? When she enters the Kapurthala city, you have to put at least 45 elephants to make a good shot. it's you cannot shoot that in a two-room apartment.
Yeah, it's much more grand than that. And are you currently working on something? Are you writing something at the moment?
Always. I'm always working on something, because once you're a writer, it's like you're stung with a virus that doesn't go away, and there's no vaccine that's been created for that. So I need my head to be occupied on something. I always say that the best moment when you write a book is when you finish and suddenly you're out of that, you know, self-sacrifice the monkish life that you've been obliged to lead during months in order to get that thing off the ground. So you're very happy, you're proud, you're happy because the story has, all the pieces have fallen on their side, on their part, and you give that to the publisher and you're relieved and you start your old life again, your daily life, you bring the kids to the theater, you go out on a weekend, you know, you do things that normal people do, not writers, when they write. And then suddenly, after a few days, you start feeling a void in the stomach, you know, like an anguish there. And you miss your characters. You've been living with them for 3 years, for 4 years. I mean, I publish once every 3-4 years. I've been living with them for 4 years. I've been, you know, my mind has been full of these characters for this time. So when you don't have them anymore, you long for them. There is like, it's a process of duelo, how you say, of mourning a little bit, you know, till you find another story. That, in fact, that's how, when I met Sonia Gandhi, I met her once a book was written. I met her in Rashtrapati Bhavan in a cocktail. So I approached her and I said, Madam, I've been sleeping with you for the past 4 years. And she looked at me terrified, like, who's this guy who's, you know, who's entered this place and security hasn't seen him. And I said, no, I mean that I've been, you know, thinking about you every day when I woke up and when I went to bed, because I've been writing about you and your family. And say, you're the one of the book. She has already heard about me. And I asked her, you know, I want your blessing because my book is finished. I want to give you the manuscript. So we don't have any problems afterwards. She looked at me and said, we never read what's written about us. Like, it was pretty arrogant to say that. And in a way, it was like my hero a little bit, you know, fell down. It was a way to say, we the Nehrus don't read what the little Spanish journalists could write about us. Well, we know the rest of the story now, you know. But what I love about India is not only all that stuff. I mean, I love the small people of India. That's where the soul of India is. When I did a book on Bhopal, I remember I befriended Gangaram, an ex-leper, very poor, from the Oriya Basti, the Oriya community, which was the poorest Basti of Bhopal. He had been a hero. I mean, I write his story in the book. He had been a hero the night of the gas tragedy. And he was the leader of his community. Fabulous, great man. No fingers, fabulous guy. And I said, I'm not gonna leave India without having the experience of spending one night at the hovel in the slum. I need to know what it is, but to experience it. So I said, Gangaram, I want to spend one night in your hovel. Invite me for the weekend. Of course, he invited me for the weekend. So there I went. One of my most wonderful experiences I had in my life, I went to that hovel in this Oriya Basti, which at that time, it was made in mud, you know, so every year they had to redo their homes. Really poor, in the outskirts of Bhopal. And his wife, Dalima, had cooked a meal, and they had that sensibility. They were sensible enough to ask, what would I like as food? So they knew that the foreigners, they don't eat as spicy as Indians. So they cooked for me a special meal that was not spicy. Everything was immaculately clean in that hovel. There were very, very few things, but it was very clean. We could have eaten directly on the floor. And then after lunch, after dinner, it was time to go to bed. So they take me to a very, very small place just beside, because it was just one room and there were two adults and three kids. And they had prepared for me a very little bed. And well, we all go to bed. And there's all these noises of the slum, You know, I was writing down everything. I was feverishly writing down the smells, the noises, everything. And I couldn't get to sleep. And suddenly I hear, like, you know, a long, somebody likes breathing, you know, long breathing. I said, who? I'm sleeping in a room with somebody else that I hadn't, you know. And then I woke up. I get on my feet, and there, and it was a calf there, you know, a little cow sleeping just in the other side of that room that was in L shape that I hadn't seen. And I slept with the calf that night and woke up to the sounds of that the sounds of life in that Aria Basti, in that slum. And I was very thankful to Gangaram for that experience. Can you realize that Gangaram then was, when he was 70, put in jail for 4 days for not paying the electricity bill? Now, that was with this government. Huh? Wow. That shows the callousness of the government towards the poorest of the poor. Mm. He had to spend 4 days in jail. Of course, these guys had always taken the electricity from the, you know, from the poles outside. I mean, that broke my heart. How can you take a 70-year-old guy like this, a leader of his community, to jail for not paying the electricity bill? Come on.
That's a really heart-hitting kind of a story, and also an incredible experience for you, you know, that you described. I could keep going, but I know that we have to wrap up the conversation. But Javier, really, it was so wonderful to hear about the process of your writing, your relationship with India. You know, we know it through your books, but it's, you know, so good to hear it from you, and how clearly how passionate you are about the country and about the stories, telling the stories of people in the country. So thank you for bringing us these stories, and thank you for sparing your time for this conversation. It was really great to speak to you.
Thank you very much, Mohini. Thanks to you. Thanks to the Jaipur Literature Festival. And, you know, I mean, in India, I feel just like, you know, one of you. I don't feel at all. I never felt foreigner in India. And I wish I could go back very, very soon. And of course, and I need also my Panchakarma treatment now because I'm growing old.
I hope so. I hope we can, you know, you can come back to India very soon and hopefully do an in-person conversation at the Jaipur Literature Festival once it opens.
Of course, I would love it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Namaste.
Thank you, Javier and Mohini, for that insightful conversation. Thank you all for watching and being such a lovely audience as always. On behalf of all of us, please stay safe, and we will see you next week on the 13th of August with the book launch of Return of the Brahman, Ravi Shankar Etet in conversation with C. Aryama Sundaram on GLF First Edition at 7 p.m. IST. And Cricket, Facts and Fiction, Sunil Gupta and Suprita Das in conversation with Keshav Guha on Jaipur Literature Festival online series at 8:30 p.m. IST. We do hope you will be able to join us. Take care and good night.
Times during COVID, when we're all sitting at home, it's sort of like a ray of light that we get to watch these amazing sessions when we can't all be together. It certainly brightens up my evenings.
आज pandemic में हम digitally Jaipur Literature Festival कर रहे हैं और मुझे लगता है कि हमारे सामने श्रोता नहीं है, हम आपस में बात कर रहे हैं, लेकिन उस फील को, उस उमंग को महसूस कर सकते हैं कि हजारों लाखों लोग हमसे जुड़े हुए हैं, हमको सुन रहे हैं और कहीं ना कहीं कोई एक सार्थक हस्तक्षेप हो रहा है।
People who came online to view and listen to our incredible speakers from across the world, we were able to continue in our tradition of ensuring the free flow of knowledge and information.